Hello students, I am teacher Svetlana and today we will continue to learn biomolecules in a cell, which are proteins and nucleic acids. And this is covered in the chapter biomolecules. So let's begin. Proteins. Mueller adopted the term protein to refer to the complex organic nitrogenous substances found in the cell of all animals and plants. Let us have a look at the protein structure. Proteins are polymeric chains of amino acid residues. The structure of a protein is mainly composed of long chains of amino acids. The structure and position of the amino acids give particular properties to the protein. Amino acids are made up of an amino functional group, that is NH2, and a carboxyl COOH group. Have a look at the general structure, one amino group and one carboxyl group. Amino acids are linked together to form polypeptide chains. One or several of such chains fold differently to form a protein. Amino acids are substituted methane, where the four valencies of the alpha carbon are occupied by hydrogen. Amino group, carboxyl group, and the fourth valency is fulfilled by a variable R group. So you have the variable group, then one you have the hydrogen group or the amino group and the carboxyl group. Depending on the R group, there are different types of amino acids, out of which 20 are found in polypeptide chain. All these properties of amino acids decide the ultimate structure and function of the proteins. The structure of protein is classified at four levels. Primary. The primary structure of a protein is the linear polypeptide chain formed by the amino acids in a particular sequence. Changing the position of even a single amino acid will result in a different chain and hence a different protein. Here is the primary structure. Secondary. The secondary structure of a protein is formed by hydrogen bonding in the polypeptide chains. These bonds causes the chain to fold and coil into different conformations known as the alpha helix and the beta pleated sheets. The alpha helix is like a single spiral and is formed by hydrogen bonding between every fourth amino acid. The beta pleated sheet is formed by hydrogen bonding between two or more adjacent polypeptide chain. Here, this is the secondary structure, which is a helix. Tertiary. The tertiary structure is the final three-dimensional shape acquired by the polypeptide chains under the attractive and repulsive forces of the different R groups of each amino acid. This is a coiled structure that is very necessary for the protein functions. Here, this is your tertiary structure where you have a folded individual polypeptide chain. Then you have the quaternary structure. This is exhibited only by those proteins which have multiple polypeptide chains combined to form a large complex. The individual chains are then called as subunits. This is a quaternary structure. You can see there are different subunits, protein subunits, which have come together and formed this structure. Characteristics of proteins. They are extremely reactive and highly specific in behavior. They are amphoteric in nature, that is, they act both as acids and bases. The behavior of protein is strongly influenced by the pH. Like amino acids, proteins are dipolar ions at the isoelectric point, that is, the sum of the positive charges is equal to the sum of the negative charges, and the net charge is then zero. The ionic group of a protein are contributed by the side chains of the polyvalent amino acid. A protein consists of more basic amino acid such as lysine and arginine, exists as a cation and behaves as a base at the physiological pH of 7.4. Such proteins are called as basic proteins. Histones of nucleoproteins are basic proteins. On the other hand, a protein rich in acidic amino acids exists as an anion and behaves as an acid. Such proteins are called as acidic proteins. Most of the blood proteins are acidic proteins. classification of proteins on the basis of structure. Proteins are classified in three categories: simple, conjugate, and derived. This gives you a schematic representation of the classification. The simple proteins. Simple proteins on hydrolysis yields only amino acids. They are soluble in one or more solvents. Simple proteins may be soluble in water. Histones of the nuclear proteins are soluble in water. Globular molecules of histones are not coagulated by heat. Albumins are also soluble in water, but they get coagulated on heating. Albumins are widely distributed. Example, the egg albumin, serum albumin, and legumulae of the pulses are all albumins. Albumins getting coagulated on heating. The example is, if you break open an egg on a hot pan, it gets coagulated. It loses its fluid transparent color. So that phenomenon is called as coagulation. Then we have conjugated proteins. These consist of simple protein united with some non-proteinic substance. The non-protein group is called as the prosthetic group. Example, hemoglobin. Globin is the protein and the iron containing pigment heme is the prosthetic group. Similarly, nuclear proteins have nucleic acids as the prosthetic group. On this basis, proteins are classified as glycoproteins and mucoproteins. Mucoproteins are carbohydrate protein complexes. Example, mucin of the saliva and heparin of blood. Lipoproteins are lipid protein complexes. Example, conjugate protein found in brain, plasma membrane, milk, etc. Then we have derived proteins. These proteins are not found in nature as such. These proteins are derived from the native protein molecules on hydrolysis. We have example, metaproteins, peptones. These are all derived protein. Nucleic acids. Students, Swiss biochemist Friedrich Mischer in 1869 discovered and isolated nucleic acids from the pus cells. Then we have Fullerton in 1924 showed that chromosomes contain DNA. He established that nucleic acid contains two pyrimidines, that is cytosine and thymine, and two purines, adenine and guanine bases. Wilkins and co-workers showed that purines and pyrimidine bases are placed regularly along the DNA molecule at a distance of 3.4 angstroms. And further, they were also identified that we have two types of nucleic acids, that is the DNA and RNA. Let us have a look at the structure of DNA. DNA is composed of sugar molecule. It is a pentose sugar of deoxyribose type. It has a phosphoric group, also called as phosphates when in chemical combination, a nitrogen containing base. These are nitrogen containing organic ring compounds. Have a look at this image here. These are the three components that form the entire structure of your DNA. This is your phosphate group, this is the deoxyribose sugar, and this is the base. This is how a chemical structure of that would appear. Principally, bases are of two types: pyrimidine bases, purine bases. Base pyrimidine are single ring. That is, they are monocyclic nitrogenous bases. Example, cytosine, thymine, and uracil are pyrimidines. Purines are double ring dicyclic nitrogen bases. That is, adenine and guanine are purines. We have Edwin Chargaff in 1950 established the relative amounts of these four nitrogen bases. They observed that the purines and pyrimidines always occur in equal amount in the DNA. That is, they found that the base ratio, that is A plus T or G plus C, may vary in the DNA of different groups of animals and plants, but their ratio always remains constant for a particular species. Let's understand the structure of the DNA. It is a very long chain made up of alternate sugar and phosphate group. Deoxyribose joined by the phosphate in the same way so that the long chain is perfectly regular, repeating the same phosphate sugar sequence over and over again. Have a look at this image here. This is how the structure of the DNA looks. A tiny portion of this is magnified. You can see here you have your sugar phosphate and the nitrogenous base here. So you will see that the phosphate of one, and then you have the phosphate of another one coming and attaching. So it this attachment remains constant so that the phosphate sugar sequence is repeated. Each sugar of the sugar phosphate chain has a base attached to it, and the base is not always the same. So you have a base attached to it. This base is not always the same. This unit, which consists of a sugar phosphate and a base, is called as a nucleotide. So this entire thing is called as a nucleotide, which has three components: the phosphate group, the sugar, and the base. The nitrogenous bases and the sugar of the nucleotide form the nucleoside. So if we have the nitrogenous base and the sugar, and the phosphate group is absent, then it is called as a nucleoside. Thus, nucleoside does not contain a phosphate group. Four types of nucleosides are found in the DNA molecule. In a nucleoside, nitrogenous base is attached to the first carbon atom, that is C1 of the sugar, and when a phosphate group gets attached with that of the fifth carbon atom of the sugar molecule of the and a nucleotide molecule is formed. So if you have a look at this carbon molecule, that is the sugars, the first position carbon you have the base attached, and at the fifth position we have our phosphate group that is attached. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So the fifth carbon you have the phosphate group attached, and at the first carbon you have the nitrogenous base that is attached. If you have a look at this image here, you can see the structures are clearly depicted here, and you have each of these nitrogen bases, and here you will see that G pairs with C, T pairs with A. So this, you can see here that the Chargaff rule, where the base ratio, that is GC and AT, always remains constant, and this happens because of the complementary base pairing that the bases show. That is, a purine always pairs with a pyrimidine and vice versa. Let us try to understand the model of our DNA. According to Watson and Crick, DNA molecule consists of two strands twisted around each other in the form of a double helix. So you have two strands. One is the red strand and one is the blue strand. They are twisted around one another. The two strands, that is the polynucleotide chain, are supposed to be in opposite direction. So end of one chain having three dash lies beside the five dash end of the another. So they are said to be in opposite direction. That is, they are said to be anti-parallel. So at one strand, the 3 dash faces the 5 dash of the another strand. One turn of the double helix of the DNA measures about 34 angstrom. So this one turn that is there, so this is complete. One turn is called to have covering a distance of 34 angstroms. It consists paired nucleotides, and the distance between two neighboring pair nucleotide is 3.4 angstrom. So between two nucleotides, this distance is 0.34 nanometers or 3.4 angstroms. The diameter of the DNA molecule has been found to be 20 angstroms. This total diameter is 20 angstroms. There are certain organisms like bacteriophages and several bacterial viruses which possess the single-stranded DNA. So there are certain bacteriophages and certain viruses where they have a single-stranded DNA. Now, there must be some students who must have this doubt in mind: how come this 5 dash and 3 dash face together or come together? To understand this, have a look at this image again here. You will see that at one strand here, the phosphate group at the 5 dash end is free and it goes on continuously. So at the 3 dash end, always you have the next phosphate group coming and attaching. So the last sugar will have its 3 dash carbon free, so that makes the polarity of the strand as 5 dash and 3 dash. And whereas the other strand, you will see it's just reversed. You will see here the 3 dash end is free, and here at the 5 dash end the phosphate group is free. So this is how it makes these antiparallel strands. Thank you, students, for participating in this lecture. See you soon again with the next topic. Till then, take care, be safe, and keep learning.